How did I get here? The young man took a long look at his life. He was penniless, homeless, filthy, and starving. You would never know that he had once lived under the loving care of his wealthy father. But he had left home, cut off his relationship with his father, squandered his inheritance on a life of sin, and ended up in this pitiful state. He finally came to his senses, and a deep feeling welled up in him. I need to go back to my father. But he was so ashamed. After all he had done, he wondered whether his father would even want him as a son anymore. In desperation, he decided he would return home and ask to be a servant. He was unaware of the depth of his father's love. Little did he know that his father had been longing for him, waiting and watching for the day he would return. As the young man made his way home, his father spotted him, even when he was still a long way off, and ran to him, embraced him, and kissed him affectionately. Filthy and ragged, the repentant young man confessed to his father his sinful life, telling him that he was no longer worthy to be his son. But his father responded by first clothing him with the best robe, and then sacrificing the fattened calf to feed him. With rejoicing, he called for a feast, for all to celebrate the return of his son, whom he declared had been dead and now lived again, who had been lost and was now found.
Folks, this morning we continue our series, Finding Your Way Back to God, and we are taking our scripture reading from the parable of the lost son from Luke's Gospel, chapter 15, 11 to 24. And last week we looked at the awakening to longing, and this morning we're going to be looking at awakening to regret. Before we start, let's just bow our heads in a word of prayer. Lord, we just thank you that we can come and hear your word, and know, Lord God, that this is not the word of man, this is the word of God, and we pray that somehow through this word that it may not seem to come from man, but only from your heart to our hearts. And so let us hear your word and speak into our lives, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Folks, in the New Testament, there are two words used for life. One is the word bios. It's the root word for biology. Bios means natural life. It can also refer to a chronological life. The average lifetime includes 250,000 hours of sleep, 76,000 meals, and about 200,000 trips to the bathroom. That's for men. Women, I think, are 500,000. All that is part of the bios life. But there's another word for life in the Bible. It's a word called zoe, Z-O-E. It includes a bios kind of life, but goes way beyond that. You see, bios is about quantity, but zoe is about the quality of life that comes only from knowing God. A zoe life ultimately refers to eternal life, the kind of life that you were made for and that will never end. When Jesus says, I have come that you may have life and have it abundantly, guess which word he uses? Zoe. Jesus is talking about a quality of life with God that changes your past, your present, and your future. And when you find your way back to God, you discover zoe life. Almost 20 years ago, there was a film entitled Kingpin. The hero was played by Woody Harrelson, and he reaches out to an Amish youth played by Randy Quaid to convince him to step out of the safety net of the Amish community that he grew up in and to go and experience the world outside. The premise of the movie comes really from a fascinating aspect of Amish history. I don't know how many of you have ever heard of a word called Rumspringer. Rumspringer. Now, Rumspringer literally means running around. And it's a word used to describe the Amish practice of allowing youth to go and sow their wild oats, as it were, in the world. Now, not every Amish community does this, but the ones that do allow that freedom for their kids between the age of about 14 and 16. And the freedom grants these teenagers permission to leave the community and to go out on weekends and experiment with the world outside in whatever way they choose. It comes with an understanding that when the child comes back, they must make a choice. One, they can choose baptism within the local Amish church. Or two, they can leave the community permanently, turn their back on their family, and choose to live in the world for good. Now, maybe we are not Amish, but that hasn't stopped us from engaging in some Rumspringers of our own. We may have other names for it. A lot of young people leaving school call it a gap year to go and explore the world. And maybe you're on your own Rumspringer right now, running from one thing to another, experimenting a little here, a little there, and maybe indulging in some things that you would never have thought about a few years ago. So let me ask you, how's it working out for you? How's your running around after all these things really working out, if you're honest? We're now in our second week of finding your way back to God, and our hope and desire is to help people find their way back to God. There are those here this morning who had a first-time experience of this right here after a service here at Willows, or maybe after an Alpha course or some other event. But I need to say that this series is not just about choosing to follow Jesus for the first time. Because we know that finding our way back to God is an ongoing process. It's an ongoing journey. How so? Because time after time we find ourselves wandering away from home. Over and over again we turn our backs on God and our community in the hope of finding something more. And again we find ourselves in a state of Rumspringer. Finding our way back to God, as John Maxwell once said, it's not a destination, it's a journey. Conversion may have been for you a life-changing moment, but it is actually a life-growing process. It's a journey, and every one of us needs to find our way back to God. And last week we began by looking at the first awakening to longing. This awakening is all about the universal longings we have for love and purpose and meaning in our lives. It's these longings that give us that restless feeling of saying there's got to be more than this. And as we said last week, unfortunately, all too many of us take those God-given longings and look to fulfill them in ways apart from God. We begin to chase stuff that we think will bring us the fulfillment that we're after. Relationships and money and career and pleasure and all of those things. And sometimes this chase leads us to make decisions that we never would have imagined we would make. And inevitably, what we thought would bring fulfillment actually falls far short. We find ourselves saying things like, I just wish I could start again. And this is the second crude awakening, an awakening to regret. Have you ever been there? A place in life where you wish you could start over. Wouldn't it be great if we could just do a do-over? Go back to that moment where we made that bad decision and we could reverse it, begin again. I've been there and I'm sure you've been there. And I'm sure there are some of us here right this morning who are at that place. We began this morning looking at the story of the prodigal son. And today I want to focus on a particular part of that story. It's this part. When he came to his senses, he said, "How many of my father's hired servants have food to spare, and here I am starving to death? I will set out and go back to my father and say to him, 'Father, I've sinned against heaven and against you.'" You see, there are two pieces of the story that we want to highlight today. The first is the part that is highlighted in red, when he came to his senses. And the second is that last part, "I will set out and go back to my father." When he came to his senses, the son was experiencing the second awakening. The first was the longing for something more, something that we've all felt, something that drove him to this distant land to try and find a fulfillment. And for many of us, we struggle with this whole question. There's got to be more. I mean, every day, eating, working, watching TV, and going through that same treadmill of life on a daily basis. There has to be more to life. There's got to be purpose and meaning. And so the son sets off for this distant land to find the something more. He winds up having wasted all his inheritance he received from his father, totally broke. He can't even buy himself a plate of food. And this is where the second awakening comes, the awakening to regret. It's the turning point of the story. He came to his senses. However long he was gone, we don't know. Whatever he did, we don't really know, except it was wild living. But he finally woke up. And I'm sure many of us have been in a place like that, and maybe even right now are in such a place. I'm not sure if you ever watched the movie Planes, Trains, and Automobiles. Anybody seen that film? It stars John Candy and Steve Martin, who are on this disastrous trip home for Thanksgiving. And late one night they hit the road, but something just isn't right. Let's just watch this part of the movie and see what's not right. Let's show it.
Put your window down!
You want some?
Who knows? And maybe on some level we're not much different from John Candy's character than we care to admit. We think we're going the right way, and we think everybody's crazy for thinking that we're going the wrong way. But then one day we finally wake up. You come to your senses. You look behind at the wreckage left in the wake of your bad decisions, and you're filled with regret. And this is such an important part of the story for all of us. We can't find our way back to God until we come to our senses and wake up. Coming to our senses and acknowledging that our decisions have taken us to places we never imagined we would ever go. Author Richard Rohr puts these words up. He says, "You cannot heal what you do not acknowledge. And what you do not consciously acknowledge will remain in control of you from within, festering and destroying you and those around you." How profound is that? You cannot heal what you do not acknowledge. And what you do not consciously acknowledge will remain in control of you from within, festering and destroying you and those around you. Many of us know that truth only too well. And maybe today is a wake-up call for some of us. It's a time to acknowledge that we're heading in the wrong direction. And that's a far cry from where we want to be. But today, the rum singer is over. It's time to come home. The son came to his senses, but then he makes the decision to set out and go back to his father, to go home. And here's the problem, friends. Often there's a huge canyon, a divide between those two, coming to our senses and the desire to return home. For some, months and years pass, even though they know the mess they're in. They know that things have to change. They don't do anything about it. And so they flounder in regret for years and years. And that canyon between desiring to start over and taking that first determined step to go home almost seems uncrossable. What the son did by going back to his father is what the Bible calls repentance. And repentance, sadly, has got a bad name over the centuries. It's got bad press because of the connotations of that word. But when you think about it, repentance is actually quite simple. It's actually, there are two words for repentance that are used in the Bible. The New Testament word that is used is a word called metanoia. It's from the Greek. And then there's this word teshuvah, which is a Hebrew word. Now, the first word means to change your mind, metanoia. And the second name is to return. Those two words are used for repentance. And so repentance, if you put them together, means to change your thinking and to return from where you came. When Jesus tells the story, he says the son finally came to his senses and decided to return to his father. Now let's just explore this repentance a little bit more, because I think it's really important. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 7:10, "Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death." Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation, and it leaves no regret. But worldly sorrow brings death. You see, there's a kind of repentance that leads to salvation. No regret. No spending years feeling guilty over what you've done. But then there's a repentance that actually leads to defeat, self-doubt, loss of confidence, and ultimately death. And this first kind of repentance is really what gets God excited and is demonstrated in this whole parable of the prodigal son. The second repentance is a repentance that brings death. Now, there are just a few aspects of this repentance I want to quickly share with you about. First of all, we read that the prodigal came to his senses. The sins in your life, the shortcomings you have that generally cause the most harm to yourself and to those around you, are the ones you can't see. The ones you may be in denial about. How often have you spoken to somebody and said, what you're doing is wrong, what you're doing is taking you on the wrong path, and they cannot see it. And you can't understand why they can't see it. And you can't understand why everybody can see it but them. You see, it's called denial. And I want to say repentance is something that happens to you. Repentance is not a decision. Repentance is not something you decide to do. It's something that happens to you. You come to your senses. It's something that you have to respond to. That is true repentance. He came to his senses. It happens to you. You don't decide one day, well, I think I'm going to repent now. You suddenly realize your life is a mess, and you come to your senses and you repent. The second aspect of this repentance from the story is that the prodigal acknowledges who he sinned against. When he returns to his father, he says, I've sinned against heaven and against you. David said the same thing when he committed adultery with Bathsheba. In Psalm 51, he says, against you and you alone, O Lord, have I sinned. It's acknowledging that you've sinned against God. And secondly, it's acknowledging that you've sinned against a person, in this case, his father. Now notice what he doesn't do. He doesn't add any qualifiers to his repentance statement. He doesn't say, Father, I've sinned against you, but you've no idea what it was like growing up with a Pharisee for an older brother. He doesn't say, Father, I've sinned, but man, young people do this kind of thing. We want to go out and have a gap year and enjoy our life. Everybody does it. I wanted to just sow my wild oats and have a fling. You've got to understand that. No, he makes no excuses. He apportions no blame. And that is the nature of true repentance. Acknowledging your sin is primarily against God and his goodness and his greatness, and acknowledging that your sin is against another. Not trying to make excuses, not trying to defend yourself, not trying to justify your actions, but really taking full moral responsibility. And then the third aspect of this repentance is very important. It's not quite there in the text, but he says, Father, make me like one of your hired servants. What is that? Well, you see, domestic servants lived on the estate. They weren't paid because it was part of their accommodation on the estate. They lived there. Whereas a hired worker lived in the town and was paid a wage. And so what does the son want to do? The son wants to go and work and pay back everything he had taken from his father. For in that he believed he could be restored to the family. He wanted to earn his way back. He didn't just expect his father to give it all to him back. And I want to say, friends, if you do the same thing, it's the worst mistake that you'll ever make. Why? Because it's the difference between religion and relationship. You see, religion is a framework of thought, an understanding of an approach to God that says, if I do everything right, if I have a good record before God, he'll be pleased with me and he'll bless me. But with that kind of understanding, in what is your source of power and confidence and hope? You see, it's not in God, it's in your good record. You are trying to do through repentance something to get your name back, to restore your good record. So I'll beat myself up, I'll loathe myself, I'll tell others how terrible I've been in the hope that my name, my self-image and reputation is restored. And if I beat myself up enough, and I let others know how bad I've been, and I let God know how bad I see myself, surely God will realize that only someone so good as me would acknowledge that. And he'll be pleased with me and he'll restore me. You see, the problem, friends, with religion, the problem with that approach is that repentance just goes on and on and on. How do you know when to stop? How do you know when you've beaten yourself up enough? How do you know when you've done enough to earn your way back to God? You see, that's religion. Lord, I promise I'll go to church every service on every Sunday. Lord, I'll read my Bible every day. I'll pray every day. I will give to that neighbor. I will do whatever I've got to do. You see, that is religion. How many times is enough? Oh, Lord, I missed the Sunday. Lord, you know, I'm condemned. That's religion. I always say, friends, you don't come to church for religion. You come to church out of relationship because you want to be in the presence of God with those who serve and worship God. That is why you're in church. If you're coming to tick a box and to feel good about yourself, that's religion. And it'll get you no further than the grave. It's got to be a relationship. And a relationship, in a relationship, everything rests on God, not on you. You simply come as you are, just as I am, as the old hymn says. Just as I am. God accepts you as you are. He restores you despite what you've done. That's relationship. And my guess is a lot of us have come to our senses. A lot of us have recognized that we've made mistakes. We've made decisions that have led us to places where we wake up with regret. Maybe it is a financial decision. Maybe it is a relational one. Or maybe it was just a decision you made in the moment that made you feel good in that moment, even though you knew what you were doing was wrong, and now you live with regret. And you've never got to the second step, and all you do is wallow in your regrets. And you wish you could start again, but for some reason you're just not willing to take that step and return. We want to change. We want to start over. We want to redo. But shame and guilt and a healthy dose of fear stands in our way. And it doesn't have to be like that. It doesn't have to be like that. Will they accept me if I come back? Is often a question we ask. Will they allow me back? Will they ever trust me again? Will God ever forgive me? Last week we introduced you to something called Pascal's wager. And Pascal's wager was when Blaise Pascal spoke to his learned friends about God and said, if God is, and you accept him, you've got everything to gain. If God isn't, and you find that he isn't everything that you thought he would be, you've got nothing to lose. And he made this wager with his colleagues and said, trust God. Take that step and trust God and see if you will not gain the whole world. And we said that this bet is a bet that we want to challenge everybody here with. A bet that God is real and that he loves you. And a prayer that we suggested you pray every day this month and say, Lord, if you are real, make yourself real to me. And I want to just change that prayer slightly because last week it was, Lord, make yourself real to me and instill in me an awakening to recognize that my longing comes from you and I can satisfy those longings in you. But this week, I suggest you pray, awaken in me the possibility that with you I can start again. With you I can start over. And that's a prayer that you can pray every day this week and beyond. And I want to challenge every one of you to pray that prayer. Lord, awaken in me the possibility that with you I can start again. It's never too late. I don't know how long you might have been in a distant country. I don't know how long you've been away from home. Maybe it's just this week. Maybe it's the past few months. Maybe it's the past few years. Maybe you've always been away from home and you've never taken that first step to come home. But I just want to assure you that there's simply two things that you've got to recognize. One, come to your senses, and two, make that decision to return. You see, the story of the prodigal son is your story. It's my story. It's our story. There's a great author by the name of Philip Yancey. He once wrote about a modern prodigal daughter. And he puts it in kind of a modern language, a modern story. And through the story, you just hear God whispering, come home, come home, come home. And I want to say, friends, today you can come home. Today you can make that decision. You can leave all your regrets behind. You can leave your guilt and your sorrow and all of that behind, and you can choose today to come home. And I sense that there are some of you here this morning because you heard about the series, and deep within you there's something that's saying, I do want to come home. And God welcomes you. And so I'm going to read the story. And in between the story, we're going to be listening to a song. You may not see all the words, but you will hear the words. And I pray that this song will speak into your heart for those of you who are at that place of wanting to turn around and repent and go back to your Father. Her name was Krista, and she grew up in a small cherry farm in Traverse City, Michigan. She was a wild child who dismissed her parents as old-fashioned because of how they responded to her piercings and tattoos. One night, Krista and her parents had a huge fight. At the end of it, she slammed the door and said, I hate you, and acted on a plan that she'd been rehearsing for months and months in her mind. She ran away to the big city of Detroit. Within a few hours of arriving in Detroit, she met a man who seemed warm and nice. He drove the most expensive car she had ever seen, and he was willing to take her in. This nice man taught her a few things that would make her valuable out on the streets. And because Krista was young and beautiful, she brought top dollar for her services. As time went on, as she got a little older and became more and more used, she wasn't bringing in top dollar anymore. And she was thrown out on the street with no money and a drug habit to support.
And I will dry underneath my nails, and the wind will rise up to fill my sails. So you can doubt, and you can hate, but I know. No matter what it takes, I'm coming home.
One night she thought back to those sunny spring days when she would be lying beneath the cherry trees, realizing that renting her body on the streets of Detroit was no way to live. She decided that she would head north, maybe move to Canada and start again. On her way north, she figured she'd try something that she thought had no chance of actually working. She mustered up enough courage to give her parents a call. No one answered, but she left a message telling them she was going to be passing through Traverse City on her way back to Canada, or up to Canada. If they wanted to see her, she would be at the bus station around midnight. After hanging up, she thought that leaving the message was a stupid thing to do, because the odds were that they were far happier now that she was gone. And as the bus headed north, she could see the sign saying the bus was getting closer to Traverse City. She ran through the possible scenarios in her mind. Nobody there to meet her. Someone there, but only to shame her and condemn her. And finally, the bus arrived in Traverse City, and she heard the bus driver say, 15 minutes at this stop, only 15 minutes. Mental rehearsing didn't prepare her for what she found when she stepped off the bus. At midnight in the small town bus depot, she walked off the bus and found dozens of familiar faces belonging to aunts, uncles, cousins, and grandparents, all wearing silly party hats. A huge banner hanging from the walls said, "Welcome home, Krista." Her dad broke through the crowd and ran up to her. And as she tried to explain herself, he wrapped his arms around her, making it clear that all he really cared about was that his daughter was home. Friends, I simply want to ask as we close this morning, is that your song? Is that your song? Are you coming home? Have you made a decision to come home? Knowing that the Father awaits, knowing that you don't have to repent over and over and over and over and beat yourself up and wallow in guilt and self-pity, in some way trying to earn your way back to God. You don't have to do that. You simply have to make a decision to come home. And He's there waiting for you. He's searching the horizon for His wayward child. Won't you make that decision this morning? If you've come to your senses, won't you make that decision to come home today? Let's just bow our heads in a word of prayer. Father God, we just come before you knowing that we have all come from different walks, different paths, different circumstances. Some of us have been away for a long time. Others, maybe it's just a few days, a week or so. But in reality, we all have to find our way back to you. We acknowledge, Lord God, there's a deep hunger in us that longs to be satisfied, a hunger for love and purpose and meaning, a hunger that can only be satisfied in you. And Lord, we acknowledge that we have sinned against you. We've sinned against our loved ones. We've even sinned against ourselves. And Lord, we just want to make a choice today, a choice to come home, a choice to acknowledge you, a God who never leaves us, who never forsakes us. Restore that relationship, Lord. And for those of us who perhaps have never taken that step in faith, we pray that they would be able to take that step even today. They would no longer live in the bondage of sin and regret, but that they would be set free and come to experience your love, your unconditional love that accepts them just as they are. And so, Lord God, just draw near to us. Draw near to us right now. And I want to just allow this morning for a few moments for us to respond to God's word. You know your life. You know some of the mistakes you've made. You know some of those things that you wish you could start over again in. And won't you just make that choice? Won't you just whisper to God? It merely has to be a whisper. Lord, I'm coming home. And if you believe that, the sincerity in your heart, that that's what you want to do, why don't you just whisper that to him right now, Lord, I'm coming home. I'm coming home. I want to tell the world I'm coming home. Lord, I just pray for every single person here today. Lord, we are not here by chance. We know that you have brought us here. And I pray right now, Lord, that you would hear the prayers of your people and that we would respond to your word and that we would find our way back home. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, friends, as we close this morning, can I just remind you that every Sunday we invite you just to come. There's just some need in your life. Maybe it's that decision that you've made. And maybe there's a time in your life that you did know the Lord and you were walking with the Lord and serving the Lord and you've drifted from him. And you just want to renew that commitment. Please just come and kneel at the rail. Don't be conscious of those around you. Just come and do that. Just come and kneel and there will be those who will come and pray with you. I want to say next Sunday is really probably the crux of our series. Next Sunday is an awakening to help, to realize that God can help you. And next Sunday we're going to invite you to take that step in faith. We invite you to make that commitment to Jesus if you've never made that commitment before. And I really want to encourage you to be here next week. And as I said last week, I really want to encourage you to draw other people, work colleagues, friends, neighbors, bring them along. They haven't missed too much, not for it to make sense from next week onwards. So bring them in that they may come to know how they can find their way back to God. And so as we close with this song, we are going to take up the offering as well for the work of God, if the stewards can wait on us for that. But let's take the offering, but let's really focus on the words, and let's just sing to God as we close our service together. Let's stand and sing, shall we?